not accustomed to presenting in a circumstance where a bell goes off at the end and everybody's got to scatter. So I'm going to kind of try to move through things pretty quickly, and I'm going to jump right into it. So what I'm going to speak to you about, we're calling corporate social innovation. It's innovation coming from the business sector to try to address problems that exist in society. It's not something people would typically think about. Now, I know we're speaking today to the schools of engineering, technology, and nursing. And, you know, BD is an engineering and technology company, and we serve healthcare. So our largest customer base are actually nurses. More nurses use our products than anyone else. So I think it's a very relevant group. And hopefully, as a takeaway today, you'll find things that might influence what you think about your own careers going forward. So I'm going to jump right into it and just ask a question. Are societal needs relevant to business? Should business even care about these things? You know, Milton Friedman, who was a famous economist, at one point said, the purpose of business is to earn profit. You know, and then maybe they can give some of that money back in philanthropy, and that's serving societal need. But they shouldn't concern themselves with this. I can tell you the trend is quite different. What you're going to see here today is quite different. But think about these needs: aging society, climate change, food security, water scarcity, urbanization, one of the biggest mega trends in the world, people moving into cities, labor shortages, as I understand, including here in this area of Utah, where you have full employment, which is a great thing, population health, and unemployment. Are these things of concern to business? Well, I can tell you things have really been changing. And if I was to share with you perspectives and how they've evolved, there was a point in time when companies said, you know what, society's problems are not our problem. We can ignore it. Think about chemical companies that were creating environmental hazards. Their role was to put out chemicals and pharmaceuticals, not to protect the environment. And therefore, they would minimize their responsibility or maybe give some money away. That started to shift, in part because companies start to become under pressure. Think about when Walmart was identified as a company that didn't provide health insurance for its employees. They were a fantastically successful company that was threatened more by a societal issue than they were by their own business model. So sometimes companies will just say, let's put some public relations out there, we'll get some good news stories out there, and that'll take care of it. Or they may give away more, or they may start to engage with some of the people who were kind of keeping track of them, their stakeholders. That started to shift to say, well, maybe as a company, we can help solve the problem, because we have certain skills. Think about environmental responsibility. You know, if companies are causing environmental problems, they certainly have an opportunity to help solve them. You know, BD has a big facility here in Sandy. We built a new sterilizer about 5 years ago, and I was told that the air coming out of it is cleaner than the air going into it. I mean, that's a remarkable thing. I thought, should I go to the top? There's a big stack, and I'll just breathe in some fresh air coming out of the sterilizer. And then companies start to have to report on their results. There are actually analysts now, sustainability analysts, like financial analysts, who are tracking companies in terms of their business responsibility. But this was not linked to their commercial activities. The most recent trends, and this has really been popularized by Professor Michael Porter, a very famous professor out of Harvard, to say, look at problems as being opportunities and build unmet social needs into your business strategy and collaborate across sectors because the problems you're trying to solve are big. So not only work in the business sector, work with governments, work with nonprofits, work with funding organizations and foundations. So you're going to see all of this somehow in that last one reflected in what I'm going to share with you. So I'm going to put another context on this as well. In the United Nations in 2000 passed something called the Millennium Development Goals, which is the smaller box that you see. And then in 2015, the Sustainable Development Goals. And these are goals that were set for all countries or approved by all countries, all member states of the United Nations. United Nations has 193 member states or countries. The Millennium Development Goals in 2000 had 8 goals focused on poverty and disease in developing countries. So that was really to lift poor countries out of poverty. That ran for 15 years. Later in the presentation, I'll give you a sense of the progress in the health area. The Sustainable Development Goals were enacted by all states in September 2015 at the United Nations General Assembly meeting, and it applies to all countries. There's 17 goals and 169 targets, and it's much broader than poverty and disease. Now, this is a backdrop for what I'm going to present, because unlike the Millennium Development Goals, which were really seen as more of a responsibility of governments and the public sector, meaning not business, not private sector, the Sustainable Development Goals anticipates active engagement of the business sector. Now, as we think about what we do as a medical technology company, we make medical devices and diagnostic instrumentation and life sciences instrumentation, no drugs, but medical technology products. There's one particular goal that's important, and that's goal 3. And each of the things that you see now up on the screen are things that we're engaged in and have been engaged in for some time. Immunizing children, protecting health workers, improving infection control procedures to prevent disease spread, strengthening safety for patients, enhancing treatment of people living with diabetes, strengthening laboratory testing, addressing antimicrobial resistance, I'll speak about this later, researching for new drugs and therapies, even if we don't produce them ourselves, and reducing maternal and newborn mortality. I'm not going to dwell on these now because they come up later in the presentation. When we do this work, we use a series of different methods that collectively we call corporate social innovation. And I have to say, BD is quite advanced in this work. And it combines philanthropy, which is giving stuff away, giving away money, giving away product. It's still very important. Some people will say, well, some of the newer stuff replaces the older stuff. It doesn't replace it, but what it does is it takes it to scale. You know, if you think about personal philanthropy, you can't give away 100% of your income and expect to survive. You can give away a portion of it. Companies can do the same. But in some of the other areas I'll describe, you can actually literally take it to as big a scale as the opportunity takes you. But that's one, philanthropy. Corporate social responsibility, which I briefly referred to a few moments ago, is when you use the capabilities, the core competencies of a company to achieve something good. So we train lots of clinicians and laboratorians to improve their health practices in developing countries. That would be an example of CSR. We're not making money from it, but it's using the capability of the company, and it's not just giving something away. Advocacy and public policy, you know, a lot of companies will have policy people in Washington, D.C. to try to influence laws to help the company. You know, we approach this to say what we do for policy most, you know, should be mostly in the public interest, for a public good that we have some experience on. So we've been involved in changing laws, guidelines, and regulations around the world in manners that contributed to society, and I'll give examples of that. And then shared value creation is the newest concept. This is the one that Professor Porter has popularized, which is to say, look at unmet needs as an opportunity and start initiatives, collaborate on initiatives that both deliver positive societal outcomes and positive business outcomes. And if you can do that through a business model, there's no limit to the scale. You can take it as far as the opportunity will take you. So just to build a little bit more on shared value creation, it is literally the intersection between social needs and business performance. And when you can combine both, you can solve the world's problems in a way that perhaps is greatly untapped today. And again, I'll be giving you many examples of these. So if we think about the company and the positive impact, first let me tell you who BD is. It's not a household name, although maybe better known around here because we have a large facility. But it's an old company, 120 years old. We have about $12 billion in annual revenues, I think, or sales. That makes us, I think, the fourth or fifth largest medical technology company in the world. We're operating in almost all countries. We have over 45,000 associates, or it's what we call employees. It's a highly ethical, highly socially responsible company. I think that it's a mission-driven company, and I know this is a mission-driven university working within a mission-driven faith. So there's a lot of, it doesn't surprise me that we've taken in more people in our engineering program from this university than anywhere else, because there's a real alignment of purpose. And our purpose, the way we state it, is advancing the world of health, and the pictures are just some things that we manufacture, including some things we manufacture not far from here. The examples I'm going to share with you where we've been able to bring positive societal impact, these are just a subset, but they're good ones. One is how we collaborate to advance global health, which is health in developing and emerging countries primarily, not limited only to that. Protecting health workers and children from disease spread, increasing access to diagnostic tests that are necessary to treat infectious disease, reducing death of newborns and mothers giving birth, containing antimicrobial resistance, and then how we take that and have embedded it into how we operate as a company broadly. And I'm going to close with some interesting pictures and stories about engaging with global leaders on this work. So first in global health. We formed a global health function in early 2004, and it was largely in response to firsthand experiences in sub-Saharan Africa addressing HIV and AIDS. Between 2002 and 2012, I probably made around 30 trips to sub-Saharan Africa, about 12 different countries, not all working on HIV and AIDS, but most of it, particularly in the early years, because at that time, HIV and AIDS remained a death sentence for anyone who contracted there. The percentage of people who had access to treatment in the early 2000s was near zero, despite the fact that sub-Saharan Africa had the largest population of people living with HIV and AIDS. And two funding mechanisms were established: the Global Fund, which is based in Geneva. It's a multilateral funding mechanism, funding coming in from many countries, and PEPFAR, which was announced by President George Bush, which is a bilateral, the U.S., that's a U.S.-funded program where we fund activities in other countries. And coming back from a trip with government leaders, many of the health leaders of the world, in December 2013, I went into the top team executive room of BD and sketched out with chalk on a chalkboard and said, here's all the areas that where we can help and we need to help, because what we know how to do is very relevant. People are only focused on the drugs. They don't understand everything else that has to happen, including diagnostic test and prevention, preventing disease transmission to health workers and so forth. So on the outside are all the areas that we're working in. I won't read them off, but you'll hear about some of them now. On the inside are how we do it. And if we had a three-hour lecture, which you probably wouldn't want, instead of a 50-minute lecture, I would go into more detail on these methodologies. But maybe it's something for follow-up, because we're actually, this is mostly empirically based, meaning that we're kind of inventing the science, if you will, as we do the work from firsthand experience. Who we work with is just as important as what we do. These problems are too significant to be solved by any one sector on its own. So as a company, we can't go in and just address the laboratory testing needs for HIV and TB patients, for example. And we have the privilege of working with many, most even, of the world's leading health agencies, like Centers for Disease Control. And I serve on their foundation board down in Atlanta. CDC is one of the best organizations I've ever worked with. UNICEF, I serve on their board in the United States. And they are devoted entirely for the life and well-being of children. And if you go across this, obviously I'm not going to read them all, but this is one of the unique privileges we have, that when you do this type of work, it opens doors to working in a different manner, and this is very trust-based work. If we were there perceived to be just trying to sell product, the door would close after the first meeting. But collaborative activity implies building mutual trust, focus on the problems you're trying to solve. If there's any one thing that works in cross-sector collaboration, it's common motivation. That your motivation, in effect, is pure. You're trying to solve a particular problem. Everyone working on that team, regardless of where they come from, is trying to solve that problem. There's no hierarchy. You know, when we work in these teams, there's no boss, if you will. It's people working towards a common purpose. So now I'm going to go into some of the examples. So around the late 1980s, HIV was well understood, but what wasn't well understood at that time was the risks in the healthcare environment. That a nurse or a doctor or even a janitorial worker working in a hospital could get stuck with glass or more often with a needle, and if that was infected blood, if the patient had hepatitis or HIV, HIV was a huge scare at that time because nobody lived from HIV. If you had got HIV in the late 1980s, there was no treatment. You know, it was just a matter of time before you passed away. So of course health workers were concerned about this. And one of the things that wasn't well understood was that needle sticks could transmit. And it wasn't until 85 that two seroconversions or transmissions occurred, one to a health worker in Africa, one in the United States, that this started to rivet people's attention on it. We were then, we are now, the world's largest producer of needles. And I was responsible, I was, I think, a senior product manager or director of marketing at the time. And I took note of this trend to say, you know, we're the world's largest producer of needles. Of course, our products do good. They don't do harm. These are accidents that are causing this to happen. But if we don't do something to solve this, who will? And if somebody else solves it better than us, what does that say about us? So we started to mobilize. And our mobilization really involved initially cross-sector collaboration. We reached out to the largest nursing society and developed continuing education CEU-accredited programs for training. We reached out to the leading activist, someone who was very critical of industry, to develop and start partnering with her because she was also open-minded, and developed a surveillance program that hospitals could use to track these injuries in their environment and then compare their data with other hospitals. So all this was going on into the early 90s. And we were investing very heavily in redesigning our needle-based products to put protective features in, which required us to literally recapitalize, meaning reinvest at all of our production in a very big company. You can see some of the most impressive results of this, by the way, right in Sandy. You'll go in and see the most sophisticated equipment. You know, equipment that I tell people, you think a Mercedes-Benz is going to roll out the end of it, and a little needle this big rolls off the end of it. That's how much technology, process technology, goes into these products. So we invested well over $1 billion. We made a lot of progress in the 90s, but ultimately to get full transition in the U.S. it required a change in national laws. so that we started policy activities along with others. 26 U.S. states passed laws to protect health workers. The national law was signed in November 2000 in the White House in the Oval Office. I was standing behind President Clinton when that bill was signed into law. And I tell some side stories. So it's a common courtesy that if you're a guest for a bill signing, you get a pen that was used to sign the bill. But there were like 18 in his office. It's the picture in the middle there. That's before I grew a beard. And the way we each got a pen is President Clinton signed each letter of his name with a different pen. One letter, you get a pen. One letter, you get a pen. It was quite a nice experience. It took 10 more years, and due to a lot of effort on our part, working with nursing societies primarily, the European Union, all member states of the European Union passed a similar law. Several other countries have as well. Now, interesting, this is shared value creation. Greater than 50% reduction in injuries to nurses just between 93 and 2004. I don't have more up-to-date data, but that was still fairly early, more than 50% reduction. This also became the largest single source of growth in the company in the last 28 years since we started. Almost $3 billion of additional sales because of the need to protect health workers. So that's shared value creation. We were able to accomplish a societal need and create an opportunity. Not in all cases do you create an opportunity. In this case, we could. During the same time frame, we were working to protect children in developing countries who were part of mass immunization programs. The mass immunization of children has been the biggest single accomplishment in global public health. In the 1970s, only about 15% of the world's children had been immunized against childhood diseases. Today, it's over 80%. But by the late 80s, the World Health Organization and UNICEF and others knew that they had a problem. The devices used to immunize children were being reused, even though they were designed for single use, and that was spreading disease, particularly hepatitis. In fact, reuse of injection equipment is the single largest source of hepatitis spread in the world, but also HIV. They didn't want to broadly communicate this because that might stop parents from bringing their children for immunization, but they want a solution, and they reached out to industry. So we were the first to respond. We co-developed with a nonprofit technology firm named PATH, based in Seattle, to develop the first auto-disable immunization syringe. You give an injection and it locks. Physically not possible to reuse it. We introduced that in 1991. It took 8 years before it really went into widespread use, and we learned a lot in that time period. What does it really take to take something that works and get it used in mass mobilization? And what we learned was, A, on our side, it was too expensive. We were selling it at our cost for a while. It was still too expensive. We had to redesign the whole device and put it into a that could manufacture a different design at low cost. But also, there were no policies for this. There was no funding for this. All those things fell into place in the late 1990s. Around 99, it fell into place. Between 2000 and today, we've supplied over 6.5 billion of these devices for safe immunization of children, and it's entirely wiped out that category of disease spread. We don't broadcast these things, but this was a major accomplishment in elimination or eradication of a source of disease spread among children. While we were doing that, by the way, does anybody know this person? There's a reason I put that picture in there, because I traveled in 2007 with the American Red Cross in Mozambique to immunize children using these types of devices, but to immunize against measles. And who was the lead on that trip was LDS. I was traveling with people from the church, and this woman was the head of the delegation. So if anybody here recognizes this person, tell her I say hello. Let me share one other thing with you. When you talk about anybody here ever heard of the term last mile reach? Just by show of hands, last mile reach. Okay, nobody's heard, well, a couple of people. Well, the ones that work for BD heard of it. Last mile reach means getting to the people most remote. You know, when we're dealing with some of these health issues like child immunization, you gotta get to places that you can't get to by car, for example. And this picture, the one that's behind me here, was taken in a mountainous region of rural Afghanistan, only reachable by foot or donkey. And what's on that donkey? Our product. To immunize children. That's last mile reach. And it's something we couldn't do on our own. It's working with UNICEF, we were able to get to the last mile. We also, in parallel, so that was a shared value program. We didn't, you know, make much on that, but it was a commercially sustainable program. We were also working on philanthropy. We partnered with UNICEF starting in 1998 to eliminate maternal and neonatal tetanus, which at the time was killing about 200,000 newborns and 30,000 mothers who had just given birth each year. That's down now by 70%. We worked with American Red Cross on measles. That's why I was in Mozambique. By the way, many of the pictures you see I took myself. So these pictures I took in Mozambique on that same trip with the LDS church. The children are holding their cards because they were just immunized, and they're proud because I'm telling you, these children have no possessions. We gave away a pencil, and it might have been a bar of gold to these kids when we gave it away. Measles deaths are down by 78%, 93% in sub-Saharan Africa. Was once the world's one of the world's leading killers of children, and polio, which is near final eradication now, 99% eradicated. BD just made a big commitment that parallels a commitment we made in 1954 when the first polio vaccine was first put into clinical studies. So another example is lab system strengthening. I mentioned before HIV and AIDS. What was happening when these funding mechanisms were scaling up was everybody was focused on the pill. Get the pill out there. But they underestimated what you need to do in the laboratory to ensure that that pill was being used right. For example, you wouldn't start the therapy back then until a patient was tested and you knew how weak the immune system was. It's called a CD4 test. We happened to make that kind of test. There were very few labs in Africa that actually could administer it. So we started to partner to strengthen fundamental laboratory capabilities. We partnered with the US State Department through the PEPFAR program and CDC starting in 2007, so we're about the 10th anniversary. That's now 10 years running where we strengthen laboratory systems in 5 countries in sub-Saharan Africa and also in India. And then we added another program on safe blood drawing. It seems very simple. You know, you've probably had blood drawn into an evacuated tube. BD actually invented that device in 1948. And most places in the developing world don't do that procedure properly. It's dangerous for the patient, it's dangerous for the health worker, and it often invalidates the lab results. So I'm going to play you a short clip now from the phlebotomy or blood drawing program in Kenya. Today we're here to announce a new commitment to establish the first Center of Excellence in Phlebotomy and Specimen Collection in collaboration with the Kenyan Medical Training College Department of Medical Laboratory Sciences in close cooperation with the Ministry of Medical Services, CDC, JAPEGO, and PEPFAR. This will be the first of its kind in East Africa. The Center of Excellence will help to strengthen Kenya's capacity for diagnosis, management, and monitoring of HIV and other diseases. It will improve the quality and safety of specimen collection by building the skills and capacity of Kenyan health workers in a sustainable manner, providing both pre-service and in-service training.
We are responsible for training over 80% middle-level health workers in the country. So you are knocked at the right door, and we are going to make sure that we do the necessary to ensure that this partnership is felt not only in Kenya, but through the region.
So there's actually a building in not far from Nairobi, Kenya, with my name on it when we opened up a training college there for blood drawing procedures. And this type of collaboration I mentioned before, corporate social responsibility, we're taking our know-how, now 70 some odd years of experience in blood drawing, and deploying it in a manner that enables that practice to be improved in a developing part of the world. I'm going to shift now to maternal and newborn mortality reduction, which is a little bit of a newer area for us. And I'm going to put forward a proposition, particularly for the engineering technology students, but this also certainly applies to the nursing students, that often innovation in medical technology was getting sort of the next increment above. So if you think about two areas of devices that are very well known, cardiac devices and orthopedic devices, typically the innovations going on there were to upgrade them further, make them more expensive, and the 15 or 20% of the world's population that might have access would have access. This is a different type of innovation. This innovation is focused on creating access for those who don't have access today. And I mentioned before the Millennium Development Goals. Well, I'm going to come back to them because between 2000 and 2015, there were three goals, UN goals, related to health. Number three was to reduce child mortality. In 1990, about 12.7 million children under age 5 died from largely preventable causes. When the MDG started in 2000, it was down to 9.6 million. And when they closed at the end of 2015, it was down to 5.9 million. So a lot of progress, but was still short of the goal that was set. But what was happening along the way was most of the interventions were really designed for children who were not newborns, not just born. They were things like immunizations and bed nets for malaria, treatments for pneumonia and diarrhea. And the interventions for the newborns really lagged, so much so that by 2015, almost half, 45% of all under age 5 mortality were newborns, which is defined as first 28 days of life. But of that 2.7 million, 1 million were dying in the first day of life. And you can think about it. I've been in hospitals all over the world. I've traveled to 75 countries. I've been in hospitals in pretty much all those countries. And you walk into what passes. I saw today in the nursing school, the simulation departments, including an open table for neonates. And I can tell you how many hospitals I've been to that would just love to have what you have in the university here for training. So there was really very little intervention in many places. And the 2.7 million doesn't include 2.6 million stillbirths, because they're not officially counted. So there's actually over 5 million newborns and stillbirths that are estimated to be happening each year. In parallel with that, around 300,000 women and girls were dying in childbirth every year. And although that number is down from what it was, this particular goal of all 8 goals was the furthest off its target, least progress against its target. And if you think about it, the process of giving birth, I mean, I know we're in a spiritual university. What is more spiritual than life? And you know, there is, from my faith, there is a saying that says women are a little bit closer to God than men because women can give birth, they can give life, which is something quite unique. The process of giving birth should not be so life-threatening. There's a fact that in a number of countries, it's more dangerous for a woman or a girl to give birth than it is for a man to go, or a boy to go off to war. It's an unacceptable circumstance. And in addition to these 300,000 deaths, there are over 10 million that have severe, often lifelong complications. So something has to be done about this. Now, goal number 6 was HIV, AIDS, TB, malaria. That goal was actually exceeded because of all the investments made in that area. So that actually did better than the goal. So as we looked at this, we knew that this was important, even though we were not in the field of childbirth. But then something really interesting happened. In the late part of the last decade, a car mechanic from Argentina named Jorge Odon saw a YouTube video of a cork being removed from an empty wine bottle and had a dream that that could be a way to deliver babies. And he woke up from his dream, he told his wife, and most of you are probably not married yet, you know how your spouse reacts, go back to sleep. But then he went to her gynecologist, who referred him to another gynecologist, and they took interest in this idea. So he developed a prototype, literally in his garage, and one of the leading gynecologists said, I'm going to connect you with someone from the World Health Organization. An obstetrician from WHO was coming to Argentina. He said, I'll give you 15 minutes. He gave him 2 hours because he was fascinated by this. So much so that the WHO championed this new device, this new concept, in a competition called Saving Lives at Birth, which was run by 4 governments, including the US, and the Gates Foundation, where it was awarded a seed funding grant in 2011. In January 2012, at the World Economic Forum meeting in Davos, Switzerland, which is an annual gathering of leaders that I go to each year, in the UN World Food Program tent, 2 senior officials from WHO scheduled a meeting with me. I had never met them before. One was a doctor who went to Argentina and said, take a look at this. We know of your reputation as a company. We know of your reputation personally. Tell us if you'd be willing to develop this. And it was quite a bit of debate, but internally, because it was not in our field, but we knew our know-how could be applied, and we did commit to developing it. We struck an agreement with the inventor. We struck a separate agreement with WHO, both of which were announced, sort of finalized and announced at the UN General Assembly meeting in September 2013. Now, you're going to actually now see the actual YouTube video he saw and how the device works. It's those 2 middle screens. So watch, whoop, what happened? No, all right, the first technical problem, there you go. There's no sound to this, but you can see a locator places essentially what is a film bag over the baby's head. The meter is air that's being filled in to form a light seal. It doesn't go around the neck, it goes around the jawline, and the baby can be gently extracted. This would replace forceps. Forceps were designed in the 1400s to extract stillborns. They were actually never really designed for childbirth, but they were commonly used. And this is for a circumstance called prolonged or troublesome second stage labor, where the baby gets stuck in the birth canal. Here, a C-section would be performed. In many places in the world, they don't have the surgical capability to do a C-section. And even then, if you can do it without doing a C-section, it's much less invasive for the woman or girl. This really started to become well-known because it's such a colorful story. So it was on the front page of the New York Times. I tell people, normally as a company, you don't want to be in the front page of the New York Times. It's not a good thing. It's usually not a positive story. This was a very positive story. This is a picture we met with the Secretary General of the UN, Ban Ki-moon, to present this. And then, completely unbeknownst to us, was this.
Incredible Machine 800, please.
After seeing a video about removing a stuck wine cork, Jorge Odon invented a medical device to ease this process. Howard?
What is birth?
Birth, yes.
Okay. Incredible Machine 1000.
Okay, now you know it's true. It's not just me saying it. It was on Jeopardy. It's got to be true. And people look at that and say, how in the world did that guy know that? Somebody's feeding them the answers in Jeopardy. But and we didn't, you know, we don't do a lot to publicize the stuff we do. That was probably picked up from the New York Times story. This device is now about halfway through its development. We had to take it. It didn't even have a drawing when we got it. It was a prototype, but not even a drawing. So we're going into the second round of clinical studies, which will be in South Africa. It'll be used on 60 women. Then we'll go into what's called the pivotal clinical studies, which will be around 400 women. And then we expect it to be available for use in early 2019. It takes a long time to make a brand new medical device. Let's see. And the business model for this is just as innovative as the product itself. I only have about 10 minutes. No, I have 15 minutes. I have enough time. So you can't, remember what I said before, that no one sector can do this on its own. You know, we're a big company. We operate everywhere in the world. We can't just take this and make it successful. We've got to get this to places that are very hard to reach, train clinicians, who, including midwives, who would have never used something like this before. And even the investment, we're going to invest about $20 million of our own money, and that won't be sufficient to do it. So we put together this business model that is sort of Uber collaboration, if you will, and mostly is public sector agencies and funding organizations, where we're taking responsibility to design the device, still working with the inventor. We're getting funding from some government organizations. The World Health Organization is actually running the clinical studies. There's two UN-affiliated organizations that are doing advocacy work. The largest professional society of gynecologists and obstetricians is going to do all the training protocols and guidelines and push that through their 125 country chapter organizations. There's a section of the World Bank that's new called the Global Finance Facility that provides funding to countries for maternal and newborn mortality reduction. We're influencing them to make sure countries can afford to purchase the device. And we're going to get last mile reach through non-government organizations, particularly through JPIGO, which is associated with Johns Hopkins University. This is as innovative as a device. I can tell you this gets as much attention in global health circles as a device does, because this is what needs to be done. And this is shared value creation, working together to address a need and make it sustainable. So I'm going to go on now to antimicrobial resistance. You're probably not worried about this now, but you should be, because antimicrobials, antibiotics, and antifungals, I mean, if you get a fever, you go to the doctor, you probably expect to get an antibiotic. You may have a viral infection. That antibiotic's not going to do anything. What it's going to do is contribute to resistance to the drug. If you have a bacterial infection, then you need an antibiotic. That's common throughout the world. Patients expect to get treated, and doctors give treatment, often without a diagnosis. That, plus the incredible overuse of antibiotics in farming and animal production. I mean, consumers are becoming aware now of how meats are just filled with antibiotics. You can get your doses, you know, if you have a fever, just go buy some chicken or steak. You know, you can probably get your dose right from that. Try to buy it hormone-free, antibiotic-free. This is a big problem, because before the first antibiotic in 1942, penicillin, if you went to the hospital with infection, probably you were going there to die. And the reason they took you to the hospital was to isolate you from other people, because there was no treatment. That's starting to happen again. And AMR, which is short for antimicrobial resistance, threatens to return the world, not just the developing world, the whole world, to an era before antibiotics. Now, if it sounds like I'm dramatizing this, just read this. I'm going to read a little bit of it. A woman in Nevada, January 2017, this was reported. This is just a couple of months ago. She died from a superbug resistant to every available treatment in the U.S. This woman was in a hospital in Reno. They tried 26 different antibiotics, and she still died. They sent her samples to the CDC, which is the world's leading public health agency, who then tested it and said nothing available to U.S. doctors, or any doctors for that matter, would have cured this infection. It's an incurable infection. More and more of this is going to start happening because of antibiotic resistance. In fact, this, on current trends, is projected to become among the leading causes of death. It's about 700,000 people who die from antimicrobial resistance now, and that's particularly high in newborn populations and people with tuberculosis. It's projected to grow to 10 million by 2050. That's more than cancer. So this is a real threat, and it's a little bit like global warming. It's not like one thing will solve this. You can't just make new drugs, because it's really hard to do. There's very little investment in new antibiotics, and as soon as they come on market, resistance will start to grow. So you got to do a lot more than just bring out new drugs. We're very relevant to this because things like infection control and getting the right diagnosis before giving the medication, that's a big change in medical practice that has to happen. And then also how you track infections and how you can predict where outbreaks are going to occur. These are all areas we're involved in. And we've been very active. We formed a cross-company team in July that I'm leading, and we've run events at the United Nations. In September of last year, the UN devoted an entire day of their highest level meeting, the General Assembly meeting, where heads of state from all over the world come in, just to antibiotic resistance. That's how much of a threat this is. So keep tuned to this. This is a very important issue, antimicrobial resistance. So I mentioned before that I would talk about embedding in management practices. I'm going to do this quickly, but as we were doing this work, I mentioned it's empirically based. We were building business models off of our actual experience. So this model we actually created back in 1999, from our experience with healthcare worker safety and childhood immunization. What does it really take to affect a massive change in a broadly used medical device? It's much more than just bringing the product to market. And then how do we work in countries? This methodology of understanding what are the real health needs and how do we partner, we start to inculcate into our country organizations and train our country leaders. You know, don't think about your role in your society as just selling product to make BD successful. Think about your role in society as bringing the capabilities of a 120-year-old global medical technology company to solve the problems that exist in your society. Another way we do embed this, that's sort of the hard side. There's a soft side of embedding this. When I was traveling frequently in Africa in the mid-2000s, I came back and presented at a large meeting, you know, larger than this. And I showed pictures and I talked about my experiences, and four people came up to me and said, hey, big shot, you know, you get to go on these trips to Africa and do all this good work. What about us? That was the impetus to start a volunteer deployment program that's now over 10 years running, where our associates from all over the world volunteer to go work to strengthen healthcare and health delivery in very rural settings. And we've done that now with 175 of our employees, drawn from 26 different locations. We've done 6 trips up until a few months ago. Our 7th trip was to Cameroon. All this is in developing countries. And I just literally 2 days ago got the first video out of the Cameroon trip, where we're helping build a hospital. So this is not just sending clinicians, this is sending engineers, it's sending construction specialists, and it's a life-changing experience. And I know many of you probably have gone on missions, so you probably have some sort of sense, particularly if you've been in a developing country, of what this is like. So I'm going to close with talking about working with leaders to address global problems. I've had a unique privilege, because of doing this type of work, to engage with many world leaders, more than I ever would have imagined. I kind of tell people, if you've seen the movie Forrest Gump, I'm like Forrest Gump. I end up being with these, you know, very influential leaders. So I've gotten to know some of them quite well. Others have been a shorter relationship, but I traveled with George W. Bush and his family in Zambia. Both Bill and Hillary Clinton I've gotten to know well through the work they've done on the Clinton Global Initiative. I've worked with the two most recent Secretary Generals. I've met Desmond Tutu, had lunch with him, Archbishop Desmond Tutu. Bill Gates does a lot of this type of work. We routinely work with the Gates Foundation. And coming out of those interactions, it further elevated the things we're focusing on. So one of them was, I'll talk about Together for Girls last. So when the Ebola outbreak happened in West Africa, we were the first company to respond. We sent in literally airplane loads of protected needle devices so that blood drawing procedures and hydration procedures, IV procedures, could be done safely on patients. The refugee crisis in the Middle East, I've been to a refugee camp on the Syrian border, and I'm working with something called the Royal Health Awareness Society to help improve non-communicable diseases, control them among refugee populations. And then Together for Girls, which I'm just going to give a 2-second introduction, but this is to address violence against children, particularly sexual violence against girls, which I learned through my firsthand experiences in sub-Saharan Africa was a key factor driving spread of HIV, but much, much more than that. And what I learned from firsthand experience was that 2/3 to 3/4 of HIV-infected youth were girls and young women, not boys and young men, because of rape and other factors that were affecting the girls. And this is a devastating issue. And really nothing was being done specifically for that. So in 2009, I founded a new partnership called Together for Girls. If you're interested, World Wide Web, togetherforgirls.org, one word for Together for Girls, you can learn more about it. I'm not going to go into detail, but you know, it's showing we're working now in 20 countries in Africa, Asia, the Caribbean, and Central America. And here's Hillary Clinton a few years ago when she was Secretary of State talking about it.
We'll take Together for Girls, a public-private partnership the State Department helped build to prevent sexual violence against children. In many places, there is simply no information about how widespread the problem is. So we support collecting data at the national level.
So that was just a short excerpt. And we're coming close to the end. I'm going to play a clip of Bill Clinton talking about our work on laboratories.
Over the years, Becton Dickinson has shifted It's sustainability efforts. This is really important. A lot of people are trying to do this. From sustainability, from philanthropy, to delivering shared value as part of a business strategy. This guy has understated what he did. He and a lot of other people around the world, mostly US and European companies, who literally had to reimagine their whole production process so they could make an acceptable profit at drastically slashed prices. They figured out a way to make this good business, at least good enough business to justify doing it, to keep several million people alive who wouldn't be otherwise. So I thank you very much.
That was a nice compliment coming from a good source. And then the last slide I'm going to show you, next to the last slide, is where I've traveled most of the last 15 months. It's been actually to the Vatican, because Pope Francis, or Papa Francesco as they call him, there has been very active on these issues of extending health access to vulnerable populations. So in this big picture, we were there actually with the inventor of the Odon device, with Pope Francis, and they're both from Argentina, so that was a nice connection point. This is a meeting in the Pontifical Sciences Building in the Vatican on addressing HIV in newborns and adolescents. And on now a few occasions, I've had the actual opportunity to meet Pope Francis, talk to him about this work. I mean, this is really special privileges, and you don't get there just being a normal business person. Not that I'm normal at anything, actually, but you get there because you're working on issues that they see the real value. And this is a little bit the blessing you get in return for doing good things. So my last slide, I'm just going to leave, well, next to last. Because of this work, BD has been named one of only 10 companies 2 years in a row changing the world by Fortune magazine. They do a list of 50 companies changing the world, only 10 were included 2 years in a row. And then some years ago, about 5-6 years ago, I was asked to give the commencement speech at where I got my degree, the Rutgers Business School. And my, I keep underestimating the number of slides. You know what, I'm gonna leave this one for you to read. This is some advice in terms of leadership development, because we're right up on the hour here. And I'm just gonna share with you what I told them. You know, hopefully so far what I've been doing is leading by example. This is gonna be the touch of preaching I'm gonna do. In your walk through life, choose your unplanned paths deliberately. That was my main message. And what that means is, you know, you're all sort of getting ready soon to embark upon a career. You don't know where that's gonna take you. You don't know exactly what you're going to be offered, how you'll progress, maybe where you'll be working. So you don't know these things. Those paths can't be planned. But the choices you make along the way will determine how much impact that you have. Those choices should be deliberate. Those choices should be set on a base of principles of what you want to contribute to the world, not only for your career and your family, but for society. And hopefully, what was evident as I spoke today was how those choices were made, because I certainly didn't plan this path. You know, I didn't know where things would go, how they would turn out. I'm pleased with the way they have. Much more still to be done. There's many problems in the world. There's a quote, which is a biblical quote, that says, God made the world imperfect so that we could work together to heal it. And I think if we all take on that sense of purpose and mission, we will have not only a good impact on the world, but a much more fulfilling life. Thank you. Thank you.